Mr. Adi Godrej is chairman at Godrej Industries, and he's joining me right now, one of the most respected names as far as corporate India goes. It's always a pleasure to have you with us here, Mr. Godrej. Prashant this side. Good morning again. What did you make of the Council of Ministers and the names which were sworn in? What are your first impressions and first thoughts, sir?
I think it was a good ministry. I was particularly impressed that the cabinet had six women members, which is, I think, extremely impressive. I also felt that having a smaller total number of ministers was a good move. Combining some ministries, I think, will work well. It will lead to quicker decision making, better decision making. I do hope that in certain cases they will appoint somebody else to take over soon. For example, I think Mr. Arun Jaitley handling both finance and defense may not be a good thing for too long. I presume it's a short-term measure until they appoint a new defense minister. So I do hope that change takes place. But otherwise, overall, I felt they were very competent people, and I think we can expect a lot of good decision making, quick decision making from this new government.
Mr. Jaitley, by the way, sir, has already sort of come out and said that him handling the defense portfolio is transitionary in nature until somebody gets the full portfolio. Somebody new gets a full defense portfolio, so he's just sort of handing
it. Yes, good to hear that. That's what I expected. Yeah.
I'm probably nitpicking here, but would you have liked to see things like civil aviation, transport getting merged? Chemicals, fertilizers is still separate from in the industries ministry that could have sort of come together. Any thoughts, Mr. Godrej?
Yes, some more consolidation would have been better, but I think the first step is very good. I'm sure within the next year or so there would be some reshuffle, and I think we can expect further consolidation at that time. When you mention about a combination of ministries with the industry ministry, one particular gap I noticed is they haven't announced who is going to handle the industry's portfolio.
So that's an important portfolio, and we still don't know who's going to be handling that.
Yes, I was surprised that there's no announcement as to who's handling that.
What we also understand, Mr. Godrej, is that there's going to be another sort of induction.
Maybe the Prime Minister wants to keep it for himself.
Maybe. But there could also be, as we understand, an expansion in about 4 weeks' time, where some more people may be brought in. Maybe then we could see.
I think
some
expansion
of these
might.
Yeah. Mr. Godrej, do you expect to see a flurry of activity over the next, say, month, 2 months or so, in terms of rolling out the agenda, articulation of policies, etc., before the budget? Or do you think we'll have to wait it out till the budget to understand what kind of policies this new government wants to pursue? What's your sense? Does it have, say, for example, the next couple of weeks' agenda ready to roll out?
I think both. Where things have to go through a parliamentary process in a budget, I think we'll have to wait for the budget. But the budget, to my mind, is only a month to a month and a half away. So it's pretty quick. There are other policy decisions they could take much earlier. And one of the major areas they need to concentrate on is improving the ease of doing business in India. It has never been very good. In the last 3 years, it has further deteriorated. And I think this government will look to improve the ease of doing business in India very considerably. Many of the steps could be announced right away. Quick decision making, less things going to government for permissions again and again. They've already announced that they want to have minimum government and maximum governance. So I think some of these steps will be announced very quickly. And the earlier they announce, the better for the economy, the better for sentiment, and the better for growth.
Right. Got it. By the way, just to come back to that industries portfolio that you were talking about, I think Nirmala Sitharaman has been given independent charge of that, commerce and industry, because the official list of who's gotten what was put out this morning.
But they said.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Because yesterday they were saying independent charge of commerce.
Right, it's commerce
so
and industry.
So if it is commerce and industry
charge.
Is good, then that portfolio is filled. Yes, but yesterday they said only independent charge of commerce. So I think they've corrected that. Yeah.
Okay, fair enough. No, the official release actually came out this morning, so I think I can sort of safely put that out.
Okay.
Mr. Godrej,
so that is clear.
Now to the broader question, how do you think this government will signal fiscal discipline even as it is imperative that it increase development spending? How do you think it's going to do that balance?
Yeah, I think both can be done. One, clearly development spending will be increased by this government. Also, certain fiscal incentives will need to be provided to see that industrial production picks up quickly. Currently, industrial production is indicating negative growth. On the other hand, this government's thinking, to my mind, is to cut out unnecessary subsidies that can save a huge amount for the government, especially fuel subsidies, diesel and things of that sort. The other thing I think this government has clearly indicated is privatization. There is huge amounts of money to be collected through privatization, selling of government assets such as land, stake in companies, etc. So I think with that, they will be easily be able to meet the fiscal deficit targets despite providing fiscal stimuli and spending on infrastructure, etc.
Right. So on fuel, for example, if you were to get a little deeper, there is diesel, right, which can be, I mean, you can sort of eliminate the remaining 5-6 odd rupee a liter subsidy tomorrow morning. But the bulk of the work there, the heavy lifting has already been done. But that will save some, but it won't move the needle hugely. Fertilizers is something which can be addressed. Food is a huge one, but that's already law. It's not been rolled out, but it's already law. So where do you think, the subsidy sort of control can really happen, Mr. Godrej? And the second point about selling off and disinvestment, etc., and getting money, certainly a lot of money can be gotten, but that also has been criticized in the past as sort of selling capital assets to fund revenue expenses, right? Day-to-day expenses, meeting the fiscal deficit number.
No, nothing.
Is that desirable in the long run? So both those questions.
Yeah, there's nothing wrong with that. Those government holding on to those capital assets doesn't make sense. And the government has such a large capital asset base, both in company holdings, in land and other assets, that it can for 20-25 years on an annual basis disinvest, privatize and get the economy going. Now see the advantages. If you privatize, all the things they privatized in the last NDA regime, those companies are running very well. They are earning income tax, excise duty for the government. So I think that process will lead to excellent fiscal progress in India. It will lead to economic growth being much better. So I think that's a very doable thing, and this government has been committed to such action.
What about subsidies, Mr. Godrej? What's your sense there?
Yeah, I think they should, almost all subsidies except where it affects the very poor, should be done away with. And it's ridiculous to have subsidy. For example, in fuel, it's not just diesel, it's also kerosene. As you say, fertilizer is a huge subsidy. And what happens with these large subsidies, including in some cases food subsidies, there's a lot of wastage. When you give a lot of subsidy, for example, in fertilizer, there's wasteful use of fertilizer when it is artificially priced at very low rates, just as there was wasteful use of diesel when it was artificially priced at low rates. As soon as we started raising the diesel prices, diesel consumption in India started declining.
Got that. So my broader question is the financial market, right? Markets around the world have forced governments to be fiscally responsible, right? Except maybe in the US, even there to a certain degree.
That's right.
But generally, financial markets have kept a tab on government spending, government expenditure. Can this new regime explain the need to spend on infrastructure purposes, hence widen the fiscal deficit a little bit and achieve higher economic growth? Is that likely to be the path that we're going to see this government following? What's your sense, sir?
Yes. Yes, and they need to explain to both the financial markets and the people of India that you are not spending on infrastructure, you are investing into infrastructure. When you do that, it helps growth. Growth in turn helps the government collect more taxes too. So it's a win-win situation when you spend on infrastructure, which is really investing into infrastructure. And even if you privatize, you were saying that you are selling capital assets, but if you do that and put that money into infrastructure, it is such a win-win situation for the country, for the economy, that that's the obvious choice.
Right. The other thing I think which we will see happening automatically, because markets have come up quite a bit, is deleveraging, right? A lot of companies which had trouble balance sheet wise had already started to delever, sell assets, etc. over the last couple of quarters. But as equity issuances will come back, that's an automatic process as markets go up. But does the corporate sector expect anything on that front from the government in the deleveraging process?
Yes, I think all the corporate sector expects is good policies that lead to GDP growth acceleration. And I think the target should be at least an 8% rate of growth in 2015-16. And if that track is followed, then clearly the stock markets will improve, primary issues will come into play, equity raising will be much more, and it'll help company balance sheets to improve. It'll help banks, because non-performing assets would reduce. So overall, again, it creates a virtuous cycle.
Got that. Mr. Godrej, it's always a pleasure chatting with you and getting your thoughts across. Thank you very much for being with us here today, this
Good
morning on NDTV.
You.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Let's take a quick break. Dr. Bimal Jalan, former Governor, Reserve Bank of India, joins us on the other side. Somebody who's always outspoken, speaks his mind on pretty much everything. I'll ask him what he made of the cabinet first up, and of course we'll talk about monetary policy under the new regime as well. We're back in two with Dr. Bimal Jalan.